Hey guys, this is Dr. Sangeeta back with you for another lecture of Dental Pathshala, and today's video is about host modulation. So before talking about the host modulation, let's talk about when the bacteria comes. Now, as usual, we are starting with the bacteria. When a bacteria comes and attacks, now what happens when the bacteria comes? There are mast cells which are already present in the fluid, and these mast cells are actually waiting for the bacteria to come. So when the bacteria releases endotoxin, it comes and releases endotoxin. Now when this bacteria releases endotoxins, now these mast cells, they have specific sites for these antigen which are present on the bacteria. So these mast cells, they degranulate. So basically there is a lot of granulation substance which is present in the mast cell, and it breaks when it fuses with the antigen. So it breaks all these contents which is present, all the granules. Now these granules contain histamines, these granules contain leukotrienes, and it contain prostaglandin, also bradykinin, leukotrienes and now also one more thing is there. Now this is the time that we again talk about this. So these are our epithelial cells. Now when the bacteria comes and it damages the cells, now what happens is the phospholipid which is present in the layer cell membrane of the tissues, now they break down. It break down, and arachidonic acid, it forms two things. One is it forms the leukotrienes again, and another thing is it forms our prostaglandins. So these leukotrienes and prostaglandins, all of these substances basically, so this AA in presence of lipoxygenase pathway, and in AA in presence of arachidonic, in presence of our cyclooxygenase pathway. So all of these pathway, lipoxygenase pathway, it gives leukotrienes, and arachidonic acid and cyclooxygenase pathway, it gives the prostaglandins. Now all of these substances are basically, they act on the endothelial cell of the blood vessels, and it causes the vasoconstriction. So all of these endothelial cells basically contract, and when these endothelial cells contract, what happens is there is a gap which is formed between the endothelial cells. So this gap is basically, so all of these neutrophils and also this histamine, leukotriene, prostaglandins, it act on the endothelial cells. So these have some special receptors which are already present on the endothelial cells, and they come on the endothelial cells and they activate the p-selectin. Now p-selectins are the receptor which are present on the endothelial cells. So these neutrophils, they have receptors for these p-selectins. So the neutrophils come and they bind with this p-selector. So they come and attach, and they start rolling. This attachment is not a fixed attachment, so they start rolling around, which is known as the margination. Now when they roll around, there is a time when they come, they squeeze out of the endothelial cells and they come inside this matrix. When these neutrophils come, these monocytes come, now in response to this bacteria, they releases some substance, they releases chemical, they releases something known as the hormones of inflammation, which are our cytokines, which are our interleukins. So interleukins, tumor necrotic factors, so all of these tumor necrotic factor alpha, interleukin 1 alpha, interleukin 1 beta. So all of these factor, actually they again act on these endothelial cells, and they act on some other receptor which are our another receptor. So these also work on the receptors, and these also act on the integrins which are present on the neutrophil and letting the neutrophil come. So more of the neutrophil, they start coming inside, more is the inflammation it started. So basically these receptors are also aggravating the inflammation, and they are working on other body parts, such as they are doing destruction. They start, when they are in lot of multiple number, then they start doing destruction. And interleukin beta up to the level that it does the resorption of the bone also. So this is how a disease spread. Now in case of a periodontitis, if we say a patient is having a periodontitis or a patient is having a pocket or any inflammation, now this is because the symptoms, the sign are due to the inflammation which is present. In fact, this inflammation is causing the destruction of the body. So guys, you will be asking, why studying this inflammation in the host modulation therapy? Because earlier concept of treating a periodontal disease was that if any bacteria is present anywhere, then we should decrease the bacteria load. For example, while doing the scaling and root planning treatment, removing the calculus, earlier initial concept was that if we remove the calculus, if we remove the plaque, then there is an relief in the disease. But that wasn't true. Later on, the specific plaque hypothesis came, which we have already studied. So, specific plaque hypothesis states that not all the bacteria causes disease. Only specific bacteria are associated with plaque, and also to treat this specific disease, we should give specific antibiotic to that specific disease. So, later on, the concept came was use of antibiotics, in which we used to give antibiotics to treat the disease. Now that we have another concept that if we decrease these anti-inflammatory cells, if we these anti-inflammatory response which are causing the destruction, so if we decrease this interleukin beta, if we decrease this prostaglandin, so if decreasing by decreasing these anti-inflammatory, because they are causing all of the symptom, they are causing all of the destruction, so decreasing these cells, decreasing this response, decreasing this chemical is actually going to decrease the inflammation, stopping the anti-inflammatory is stopping the inflammation, and if we stop the inflammation, that means we can overpower the disease, we can actually win the disease. So this is how the host modulation therapy is all about, that we are modulating the host response. So basically, when the bacteria comes, our body does some mechanism, it releases some substances which are in, if they are uncontrolled, it is causing destruction of our body itself. So inflammation is, if it is uncontrolled, if it is chronic inflammation, it can even cause the resorption of the bone, destruction of the tissues, destruction of the periodontal structures, destruction of the tooth supporting structures. So basically, if we can reduce this inflammation, then we can also reduce the disease. So this is the concept, that is the recent mechanism to overpower the disease, to resolve the inflammation and resolving the disease. So this is about the host modulation therapy. So in today's video, we are going to talk a little bit about the host modulation therapy. So let's get started. So guys, before we get started, make sure you subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon. That way you get a notification as soon as I release a video lecture, in case you enjoy watching our videos. So talking about the host modulation, see, there are bacteria already present in the body. Now you will be like, ma'am, if bacteria are present, then why is there is an occurrence of disease? So if the balance, there is a balance between the host as well as the bacteria, okay? And when this balance is disturbed, when there is an imbalance between the host and bacteria, now it leads to the disease. And this, there are also these bacteria, they have this defense mechanism for each other also, like we have studied in the plaque, that for example, P. gingivalis, it releases gingipins, or some gram-negative bacteria, it releases the lipopolysaccharides. So all of these bacteria also release some virulence factor. These virulence factor destruct the host tissues also. This destruct the other bacteria also. So also these bacteria are causing something which is destructing the body, as well as the immune cells also. An inflammatory process of our body, like in case of a chronic bacterial infection, is there. Bacteria comes. Now there is a gingival inflammation which is going to happen. Now because of the result of this inflammation, there is a destruction of the supporting tissues. Now we are going to talk about how is the destruction happening. That we will talk about in detail. How our monocytes are actually converting into the osteoclast in the presence of prostaglandin. And then in the presence of basically the cytokines, the tumor necrotic factor alpha as well as the interleukins beta. So all these are the cytokines, right? So these cytokines are released due to the inflammatory process, as we all know that. First of all, the first thing is bacteria invades. When the bacteria invades, it make either a plaque or it make a biofilm basically, or this plaque can be calcified to form the calculus also. Now when this plaque is formed, when there is a bacteria invasion, it reaches, first of all there are gram positive bacteria initially, the primary colonizer, and then these bacteria eat up all the oxygen, and then gram negative bacteria start coming. When the gram negative bacteria start coming, then these gram negative bacteria are tissue associated, they go inside. These positive are only the tooth associated, okay, they only come and attach to the tooth, but later on the bacteria which comes later on, they can go inside in the gingiva, in the tissues also. So these are the tissue associated bacteria, and they do all the tissue destruction, they do all the periodontal destruction. Now when they go inside the gingiva, now all these things happen. When they go inside, now these bacteria releases the lipopolysaccharide or any virulent factor if these bacteria are having, okay. Most of the time if gram negative bacteria, because it invades, so these have lipopolysaccharides, which is the virulence factor. Also these bacteria contains antigen, okay. Now the body has antibodies for this. These mast cell, they attach to the antigen which are present on the surface of the bacteria, which we have already covered. Now this is the reason that I have made this inflammation chapter, inflammation video, so that I want you to understand the whole concept. So what happens is, when the bacteria comes, our body releases neutrophils. When these body, our body releases neutrophils, these neutrophil will come and phagocyte the bacteria. Basically, they will eat up the bacteria. And we also have antibodies present for the bacteria inside the body. And when these bacteria overpower our body, okay, when there is a lot of bacteria coming, or the bacteria is so powerful, then the body releases cytokines. So these neutrophils which are coming, these monocytes which are coming, they releases cytokines. They also releases prostanoids. So these prostanoids are basically our prostaglandins. These prostaglandins are released, MMPs are released, matrix metalloproteins proteases are released. So basically these are the anti-inflammatory cells. This is the anti-inflammatory response. In this response, anti-inflammatory response, especially tumor necrotic factor alpha, interleukin beta, so all of these interleukin 6, so basically all interleukin 8, basically all these things are, when they are so much in the connective tissue, they destruct the collagen, they destruct the connective tissue, as well as they destruct the bone also. Like if we talk about MMPs, they have destruction, they have osteoclastic activity. So if they are a lot present in the body, actually they are due to inflammation. They start due to inflammation, but they don't stop. They keep on doing their work and they keep on eating the cells of the bone. So all of these inflammatory process, there is a destruction which is happening in the bone as well as in the connective tissue. So because of these enzymes, because of the cytokines, because of the prostaglandins E2, and because of the osteoclastic function, now these monocytes are actually converted into osteoclast. Basically, there were no bone eating cells. But in presence of these cytokines, these cells are start eating the bone also. So due to this inflammatory response, there is clinical stage of periodontitis. There is a periodontal destruction which is happening due to the inflammation, due to our body response to the bacteria. So this concept of host modulation was given by Williams in 1990 and Golub et al. In 1992. And this model represents the periodontal disease model given by Corman in 1997. So this is a model how these symptoms of periodontitis, they occur, how the destruction is happening. So Golub in 1992 actually gave the host modulation, and he observed this with the help of tetracycline. So Okaranza in 1996 also, he told that periodontitis is actually associated with plaque, but also there is some host response which is associated with the periodontitis. So the current concept or the definition of host modulation therapy is that a treatment which is reducing the tissue destruction. So because these anti-inflammatory are doing the tissue destruction, okay. So the host modulation is a treatment which decreases the tissue destruction and stabilizes or even regenerate the periodontium. So it is also regenerating the periodontium. It is decreasing the destruction. It is even regenerating the periodontium and modifying or regulating the destructive aspect of the host response. So whatever destruction is happening due to the host response, we are modulating these host responses. We are modulating the factors which are causing destruction and these factors which are related to the host by upregulating or protective responses, by upregulating or protective or regenerative responses. So basically we are doing some regenerative responses in which we are decreasing the tissue destruction, because all of these things are destructing the tissue. So basically in host modulation, all of these things which are doing the inflammation, we are reducing these. Okay. We are reducing all the cytokines, we are reducing all the prostaglandins, MMP. So whatever is doing so much of tissue destruction, which is due to the body response, which is due to the host response, we are working on it. So this is how we are decreasing the inflammation and decreasing the disease. So guys, I hope that you are understood with the host modulation therapy, what it does basically, how it works is that the normal defense mechanism of the body is switched off. It doesn't stop inflammation, but it reduces the excessive destruction which anti-inflammation host response is doing. Basically, it is not stopping the inflammation response. If it stops the inflammation response, that means bacteria will overpower us. So that will be, that bacteria will start doing more destruction. We are not stopping the inflammation process. We are just reducing the excessive destruction which these anti-inflammatory process, the inflammatory process of body is doing. If it is destructing a lot of things, then we are reducing it so that it can just work on the bacteria, not on the body. And this, by doing this, it is also fastening up the wound healing of the body. So coming to the classification, basically the host modulating therapy or the host modulating agent can be given in two ways. One way is if we give in the systemic form, that means we are giving in the tablet form, okay. The other one is we are giving it locally, such as on the site, if there is a site of periodontal destruction, we are giving in the site itself, okay. So the systemic contains the NSAIDs, also bisphosphonates, and our sub antimicrobial dose doxycycline, which we will study. Don't worry, we will study all. So also locally we'll give the local NSAIDs and enamel matrix protein. Also we can give the growth factor such as bone morphogenetic protein, we can also give. So based on the mechanism of action, this classification was given by Salvi and Lang in 2005. This is a very important classification which we are going to talk about. Now, this host modulation therapy actually based on, this is modulating all these things. Now we know that arachidonic acid, when there is, these are the body tissues, okay. So when there is a bacteria which comes, and this bacteria releases this endotoxin, it is causing destruction of these cells. It is causing destruction of the tissue. So in this tissue destruction, the body or the tissues which have arachidonic acid, they convert into two things. One is the leukotrienes, which is our lipoxygenase pathway. Another one is the prostaglandins, which is the cyclooxygenase pathway. Okay. So these arachidonic acid are converted into two cytokines. These are cytokines, if you remember, the leukotrienes and prostaglandins. Basically, they will also do inflammation, they will do vasoconstriction, and then they will open up the channel, so more neutrophils will come. So all of these things, these both things are doing. So basically, arachidonic acid modulation we are doing, we are not letting this arachidonic acid form these inflammatory mediators. So we are blocking these pathway, both of these pathways. So this is how we are modulating, we are working on the arachidonic acid so that not more inflammatory cells are released. We are letting only the mast cell release, not the body. So this is the first thing. Another one is the MMPs. Now these matrix metalloproteinases, if you remember, the neutrophils which come inside, okay, and the monocytes. Now these monocytes, they release cytokines, and these cytokines are basically TNF, tumor necrotic factor, alpha, interleukins, okay, interleukins 1 alpha, interleukin 1 beta, so many interleukins, okay, 6 interleukin, 8, like that. Also it releases MMPs. Now, these MMPs basically they have osteoclastic activity. They eat up the bone. So, if we are removing, modulating this MMP, then we can remove this bone destruction. We can prevent the bone from resorbing. So, this is how these MMP work. Now, the third one is modulation of bone remodeling. Basically, we are using bisphosphonates. These bisphosphonates are drug. These drug actually work on the osteoclastic activity. So they will stop all of the osteoclastic activity. So whatever the bone cutting action which is going on inside the body is stopping, these bisphosphonates are stopping the bone from going to destruction, from going to osteoclastic activity. Basically, it is not letting the bone to cut cells. So the cutting cells of the bone are, these bisphosphonates are stopping the action. So basically they are preventing the osteoclastic activity. Clastic means cutting. Then next come the host response. Modulating the host response means, there, if you remember, there are specific receptors. Now, like the mast cells, like these mast cells, they have receptor for the antigen, like that. All over on the neutrophil, we have receptors on all the cells. So we are basically blocking these receptors for interleukin 1 as well as for TNF, tumor necrotic factor alpha. So we are basically blocking these receptors so that the product cannot be released. Not more inflammation is going to happen by blocking these receptors. So the last one in the, based on the mechanism of action, modulation of NA synthetase activity. So basically what happens is there is a release of nitrous oxide when there is an inflammation process going on in presence of prostaglandins. So in presence of all inflammatory cells, there is synthesis of nitric oxide which is happening. So we are blocking this synthesis of nitrous oxide. So let's discuss one by one how modulating these things can modulate the host response, how we can overcome the more destruction which is happening due to the bacteria, and by reducing the host response, how we can work on the clinical signs and symptom of the disease, how we can manage the disease, how we can prevent the disease by actually modulating the responses from the host, by modulating the arachidonic acid, by modulating the MMPs, by modulating the bone remodeling, by modulating the host cell response, and by modulating the nitrous oxide synthesis activity. So let's discuss it one by one. So guys, coming to the modulation of the arachidonic acid metabolized, now von Euler in 1939, he said that a vasoactive substance is present, is seen in the rabbit, which decreases the blood pressure of the rabbit. Now, it is derived from the human seminal vesicle fluid. And you know what I'm talking about? I'm talking about the prostaglandins. So, basically, he discovered the prostaglandins, what we know as the prostaglandins. Now, what happens is arachidonic acid, it releases either leukotrienes. And both, actually, not either, both leukotrienes as well as the prostaglandins. Okay, this conversion of arachidonic acid to the leukotrienes is happening in the presence of lipoxygenase pathway. And the conversion of arachidonic acid to the prostaglandins is happening in the presence of cyclooxygenase pathway. Cyclooxygenase 1 and 2 enzyme is. Okay, now what is happening is these NSAIDs, NSAIDs you have studied in pharmacology, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. Basically, these drug reduces pain in case of inflammation. So we have talked about in the inflammation video itself about NSAIDs, how these NSAIDs work. So these NSAIDs, basically they go and they block this pathway. They don't let these prostaglandins forms. Now these prostaglandins are basically doing all of the inflammation. These prostaglandins activities coming from the neutrophil, macrophage, fibroblast, gingival epithelium. Basically these are also forming in response to the lipopolysaccharide which is released by the bacteria. So these level of prostaglandins, basically if we talk about PGE2, this level of PGE2 increase in the level of PGE2 is seen with the periodontitis, and this has been told by Plamondon and Sorsa in 2002. He told that there is increase in the PGE2 level seen in the periodontitis patients. So basically, if we decrease this PGE2, then there may be decrease in the periodontitis, which is the concept behind modulation of the arachidonic acid metabolites. So by giving NSAIDs, by giving idomethacin, by giving naltrexone, fluorobiprofen, so basically ibuprofen and all you must have heard of, it decreases the inflammation and it also decreases the gingival destruction if it blocks this pathway. So by giving NSAIDs, basically we are blocking this arachidonic acid conversion to the prostaglandin conversion. So guys, what happens is there is a bacteria. When this bacteria comes, it releases lipopolysaccharide, and in this endotoxin release there is an inflammation process which is started up. Now it releases, body releases interleukin 1, tumor necrotic factor alpha, as well as interleukin 6. Now what happens is we have monocytes or we have osteoblasts which are present in our body, right? So these monocytes, actually these monocytes have receptors. These receptors, which are known as Mr. Rankel, and also there are monocytes which are present in the body. Now these monocytes, basically these are the osteoblasts, okay? So these monocytes, they form the precursor molecule. They form a precursor molecule which has receptor for rank L. So they have this receptor which is known as the rank receptor. Okay, so these monocytes basically in the presence of tumor necrotic factor alpha and interleukin 1, these monocytes are converted into something known as the precursor cells. So these precursor cells, what happens, these monocytes or these osteoblasts, they have rank L receptor which is present for the rank 1 receptor. Now these monocytes or osteoblasts, they come and they attach to these rank receptors. Now these osteoblasts have rank L receptor for rank receptor. Now you can also remember it as, this is the guy, this is our guy, okay? And there is a girl which has come newly to the field. Now this girl is looking for the guy, and this guy is our Mr. Rank Londiabas L. So this is our rank L. So if he finds this girl rank, it get attached to this. Now what happens when they both get attached to itself, they differentiate, okay? They differentiate and then they proliferate. They differentiate and proliferate to form what? You will be surprised to see. Now if you are watching our videos, you know what these cells are. They differentiate and proliferate to form osteoclast. Now these osteoclasts are going to cut all the bone. So basically this bacteria, it releases lipopolysaccharide, and then after it releases endotoxin, there is an inflammatory process which is happening. And this inflammatory process, the end result of this inflammatory process is interleukin 1, tumor necrotic factor alpha, as well as interleukin 6. Now these osteoblasts which are present in the blood, they have rank L receptors, okay? And monocytes in presence of tumor necrotic factor alpha as well as interleukin 1, it makes the precursor. It makes a precursor on which they have the receptors for rank L. So these receptors are known as the rank receptor, which are present on the precursor. And these osteoblasts have a precursor known as the rank L precursor. So this combination cell, it actually differentiate and proliferate to form the osteoclast. Now these osteoclasts, as the name suggests, they are the cutting cells. They are the bone cutting cells. So these osteoclasts, who has the ruffled border, they releases carbonic anhydrase. When they release carbonic anhydrase, it break down into H plus as well as carbonic acid. Now this H plus is basically transported via proton pump. Now this is present on the ruffled border of the osteoclast, and it comes transported to the bone. Now the bone is acidic. Now the bone has H plus, which is coming from the osteoclast. And in presence of acid phosphate is there is an acidic environment which is created. This H plus is in the bone, which this acidic environment is responsible for the bone resorption, and this resorption keep on happening. Now you will be asking, ma'am, till when this resorption is happening? Till we have some other girl out of town, she is coming, which is known as our OPG. Now this OPG also has receptors like rank L receptors. Now these OPG, what they are, these are actually present in the blood. Now this OPG is the osteoproteogens. So these osteoproteogens, they are increase when they are seen when there is an increase in the calcium level. So these osteoproteogens are activated, and basically they leave the rank L, they fight with the rank L receptor, because you know they actually fight with the rank L receptor and they get attached to the rank receptor and they break down this bond and they make a bond with the OPG. Now this OPG bond is formed with the precursor, with the rank receptor. So this OPG bond is formed with a precursor cell. So basically this rank L leaves the rank, so there is no more osteoclastic activity which is happening. So this is how the osteoclastic function, it stops. And now how the drugs are working, let's see. So guys, what happens is if we give drug like NSAIDs, like MMP inhibitors, like P38, so P38 is slow enzyme activator. And if we get drug like NF-kappa-B inhibitor, which is our nuclear factor of kappa-B inhibitor, it blocks the interleukin-1 basically, and the rank L2 osteoblasts. Also, if we give kinase inhibitor or interleukin-1 trap, so all of these drug basically, they don't let the formation of interleukin-1, tumor necrotic factor alpha, or interleukin-6. They are not letting this formation, so they are blocking this formation. Now, the next one is from the monocyte when there is a conversion into the precursor cells. Okay, so there is a conversion which is happening in the presence of tumor necrotic factor alpha or interleukin-1. So, if we give drug like interleukin-1 trap or nuclear factor of kappa-B inhibitor, so these two drugs are basically inhibiting this interleukin-1 action. So, they are not letting this precursor cell form by blocking the interleukin-1 receptor. And if we give TNF, SRC, so this is basically the tumor necrotic factor receptor antagonist. So basically it is a complement which stops the tumor necrotic factor alpha. So that is how it is blocking the tumor necrotic factor alpha, not letting this precursor cell formation. So the another one is this rank L rank bonding. So if we give this P38 inhibitor, it is stopping this formation, bonding happening between the rank L and rank receptor. Also if we give OPG and if we give the S, so OPG is our osteoproteogens. Osteoproteogens are basically, they, you can remember it as oi pagal girl. Abhi, what happens is this girl come all of a sudden, now they have a good bonding, okay, they were like good best friends. So this girl comes all of a sudden in between and wo kya kara deti hai, in dono ka breakup kara deti hai. So she is making rank L fight with the rank, and now the rank and rank L are separated, and this osteoproteogens, oi pagal girl, she comes and then she get attached with the rank. So this is how this bonding is stopped, and that is how the osteoclast activity, there is no more formation of osteoclastic activity. So there is, that is how the formation of the bone, the cutting of the bone stops. Also the S rank L and bisphosphonates are basically stopping the osteoclastic activity, and also the MMP inhibitors. So these are all the modulation of the AA metabolites, arachidonic acid metabolites. So this is how they are stopped by inhibiting the prostaglycans, by decreasing the inflammation. And if we decrease the inflammation, then there is no pain. There is basically there you used to treat the pain, acute inflammation or chronic inflammation, basically inhibiting the osteoclastic activity in the periodontitis. And NSAIDs like indomethacin, naproxen, basically indomethacin was used by William, and Howell used naproxen as NSAID for reducing the periodontitis by using the host modulation therapy, and they administered this for 3 years on a daily basis, and they showed that it proved that there was a slowing of the bone resorption process if we give these AA metabolites. these NSAIDs, but everything has some drawbacks. So the NSAID's side effect or drawback was it has some GI problems. In fact, if you take ibuprofen, I to have lot of acidic issues. If I take ibuprofen for 2-3 days, I will have GI problems. So also it induces the hemorrhage because of the decreased platelet aggregation, and there is some impairment of the renal as well as the hepatic system is seen. Now there is something which is known as the rebound effect was seen. So rebound effect is basically an effect in which something is reversed. So basically, after the long term use of NSAID, it was seen that there is a decrease in the count of resorption of the process of bone. Basically, the rate of resorption, it slowed down after using long term use of NSAID. But when this long term use of NSAID was stopped, what happens? It was seen that the bone returned to the same or even accelerated bone loss rate. There was even increase in the loss of the bone, increase in the rate of the loss of the bone, which was seen. So it was a rebound effect, which was seen by Williams RC in 1991. So this is about the metabolites of arachidonic acid. This is how we modulate, we give the NSAIDs, which basically blocks our cyclooxygenase pathway, and all of these are given for the modulation of AA metabolites. Either you can give NSAIDs. How it works, basically it is the whole mechanism. So inflammatory processes, interleukin TNF, tumor necrotic factor alpha, and interleukin 6, when we are blocking this formation by giving NSAIDs, MMP inhibitor, P38 inhibitor, nuclear factor kappa B inhibitor, kinase inhibitor, interleukin 1 trap. So, and monocytes are converting into precursor cells. Now these osteoblasts have rank L receptors which are present. Also the monocytes also have these receptors. So these receptors bind to the precursor cells receptor, which have the receptor for rank. So basically they form to each other and they form the osteoclast, and this is how basically these inflammation is reducing the bone resorption. This is how when the inflammation process is happening, there is a resorption of bone, which is seen in the periodontal diseases. And if we stop it, we can stop the inflammation, we can decrease the clinical signs of the disease, we can treat the disease by modulating the host responses, by modulating the arachidonic acid metabolites, but also it comes with certain drawbacks. So talking about the modulation of our bone by bisphosphonates. We are giving bisphosphonates. Now what happens when we are giving bisphosphonates? Now this bisphosphonate is actually responsible for bone resorption. And when we give bisphosphonate, it is reducing the osteoclastic activity. It is interfering with the metabolism of the osteoclast, and it is disrupting the osteoclastic activity. It is inhibiting the bone resorption. That is how bisphosphonates, basically these bisphosphonates are bone seeking agent. So these are bone seeking agent. So they have some anti-collagenase property. So basically they break down the collagen and break down the bone, because if we are giving this bisphosphonate, basically we are stopping these osteoclasts. So we are reducing the bone destruction. So we are reducing these bone destruction, we are reducing the osteoclast. So what happens when there is no bone resorption going on? That means the density of the bone, it increases. When the density of the bone increases, that means there is not porous bone now. Now the bone which was porous earlier, okay, now this is a dense bone. When a bone is dense, that means this bone has less blood vessels, this bone has less vascular supply, and this, because of this increase in the bone density, there it causes avascular necrosis. There is less blood supply, and if you do extraction in this bone, there is high chances that this bone may undergo necrosis. So this is the reason we don't give bisphosphonates anymore. Now third one is modulating the MMPs. If you see, modulating the MMPs, if we are inhibiting these cytokines, that means if we are giving the MMP inhibitor, we are not letting the MMP form. Basically these MMP, they are doing more of the collagen destruction. So they are, because of these MMP, there is collagenase activity and these collagenase activity are going to destruct the connective tissue and further going to destruct the bone also. So we are stopping this MMP activity by giving the MMP inhibitor, and the one all time favorite MMP inhibitor is our sub antimicrobial doxycycline dose. So basically we are giving doxycycline. Okay, so we are giving doxycycline 20 mg of dose. This 20 mg dose of doxycycline is known as periostat. Now this is a two marker question which is frequently asked in your exam. What is periostat? So periostat is a sub antimicrobial dose of doxycycline 20 mg sub, and now this dose is actually reducing, used for treatment of chronic periodontitis along with the scaling and root planing. So this is inhibiting the MMP and thereby reducing the MMP formation and thereby reducing the inflammatory responses. So this doxycycline, you will be asking me, ma'am, why only doxycycline? Why not tetracycline? Why not minocycline? Because this doxycycline is more effective inhibitor of collagenases. That is why we are, because we want to inhibit the collagenase, because we don't want collagenase to destruct all the fibers or to destruct all the collagen. So basically this doxycycline is it is inhibiting the collagenases more powerful than the minocycline and tetracycline. But also, so everything has disadvantages, but the good thing about doxycycline periostat is that doxycycline actually comes in the 50 mg or 100 mg dose commercially available, which is, but this periostat is, why do we call this sub antimicrobial? Because the commercially available dose is 50 mg to 100 mg, but we are not giving 50 to 100 mg. We have specifically designed for dental purpose, we have specifically designed this doxycycline only for 20 mg. Okay, this 20 mg has less side effect because the dose is less, but it is very effective in treating the inflammation, in treating the periodontitis. So this periostat, which is 20 mg dose of doxycycline, is very helpful, and therefore because this is reduced dose, so there are no as such side effect also seen along with the subacute antimicrobial dose of doxycycline. And this subacute antimicrobial dose of doxycycline is actually effective for MMPs also. Now what happens? These MMPs are released due to a part of inflammation. As we all know, they are released mostly by activated macrophages, but they are also released by lymphocytes. So basically in case of a chronic inflammation, these MMPs, matrix metalloproteins, are released due to response of cytokines or chemokines. Okay, and what they are doing, these MMPs, if you remember our pathology, we have talked about inflammatory. Okay, in inflammation we have talked about these cytokines, they are actually guiding all the neutrophils. So these MMP are guiding all the neutrophil on the way to reach the bacteria. So basically all the neutrophils which have come from the blood vessel and they have come in the interstitial fluid. Now these chemokines are basically, they are giving the signal, they are giving the path to reach to the bacteria, so that all the neutrophils, all the monocytes which are collected here, which can go to reach the bacteria and destroy the bacteria. So basically is the purpose of this MMPs. So MMPs, what is doing, how it is making the path? Basically it is destructing all the collagen. So in a jungle, you can understand is that there is a jungle. Okay, whole of the tissue is the jungle. So this MMP is cutting all the trees and making a path for the neutrophils to reach up to the bacteria. So basically these MMP are zinc dependent enzymes and they are degrading the collagen. So in the periodontitis cases, there is a breakdown of connective tissue matrix, and which is due to majority of the MMPs. Which kind of MMPs are seen in the periodontitis? Now we have MMP 8 and MMP 9. Okay, these two are the MMPs which degrade the type 1 collagen. Type 1 collagen, as we all know, is seen in the gingiva, is seen in the PDL. So basically these MMP 8 and 9 are derived from the neutrophils, because in the inflammation right now we have neutrophils, because we want the neutrophils to give the path. So we want the neutrophils to guide to reach up to the bacteria. So these are the PMNs type of MMPs, and which are increased with the severity of the periodontal disease. And after we give this sub antimicrobial dose of doxycycline, there is reduction in the symptoms of the disease, there is reduction in the these MMPs. So basically this is how this SDD works, this subacute antimicrobial dose of doxycycline works as a modulation of MMPs, matrix metalloproteinases. So coming to the last one we have is the NO synthetase inhibitor. Now this is a newer agent that is used for host modulation. And as I've told you, there is a nitric acid production in case of inflammation, in case of the cytokines. So there is a nitric acid production, and this mercaptoethylguanidine, basically it is preventing the tissue destruction by inhibiting this nitrous oxide. So also we have the locally administered agent. If you remember in the classification, we have talked about the systemic as well as we have talked about the locally. So systemic, we have already covered NSAIDs and bisphosphonates. So now talking about the locally administered. So locally administered are basically implanted at the site where there is more periodontal instructions. Basically these are inserted. So such as enamel matrix proteinases. So these are come in the name of the endogene. Also we have bone morphogenetic proteins, BMP2 and BMP7. Now BMP2 is basically absorbable collagen. So we will talk about, so basically they are more like a GTR. So they are the absorbable collagen, bone morphogenetic protein, and they are used also in for ridge augmentation as well as for healing process. So they come, BMP2 come in the brand name of Infuse. So BMP2 Infuse. So basically they are used along with the surgeries so that there is not much of destruction which is happening, so that the body inflammation is not fighting, so that there is no inflammation, less of inflammation. Also we have growth factor, the platelet derived growth factor, in that we have GEM-21S, and this is also helpful in the wound healing and diabetes patients, and we can also use the insulin as well as the tetracycline. We have some new agents also, like these locally HMTs. So host modulating therapies are used along with the surgical procedure. So where you are doing surgeries, these agents are used along with the surgery, so that there is improvement in the wound healing, so that the all of the bone which is lost is regenerated. We will talk about in the surgical part what is regeneration. So regeneration is basically from the original cells itself. So when the basically the cells, like if the odontoblast, example I'm giving you, suppose if the odontoblasts are forming the dentine. So again these, there is a formation of odontoblast which is forming the dentine. So basically the original cells are forming the cells which were previous. So regeneration is that. So regeneration by the lost bone, regeneration by the PDL, and when in case of a complete periodontal attachment apparatus is required, we administered these locally administered agent, locally HMTs, host modulating agents, along with the surgical procedure. So talking about, we have new agents, we have some newer agents in the market, the host modulating agents, in that we have one recombinant human interleukin 11. Now this is an inflammatory, it inhibits the tumor necrotic factor alpha, and therefore it is used as an anti-inflammatory. We also have omega-3 fatty acids. Now these omega-3 fatty acids, they actually blocks the Cox pathway. If you remember, the Cox pathways from arachidonic acid to the prostaglandin. So basically it is blocking this pathway. It is not letting the prostaglandins form. And also the leukotrienes, if you remember the lipooxygenase pathway, the it is also blocking the leukotrienes also. So this omega-3 fatty acid, when it is given with the celecoxib, this is the celecoxib is also a Cox inhibitor. So this celecoxib also works on the same way. It blocks the prostaglandins formation from the arachidonic acid. So both of these effects are same. So there is a synergistic effect of both of these drugs as an inflammatory drug for the host modulation. So this is about the host modulation process, host modulation therapy. I hope that now you know what is host modulation. Because previously when I used to study in the BDS also, like there was a time when I didn't understand this chapter at all. Now this host modulation is basically a new technique to overcome a disease, new technique to treat a disease. This host modulation therapy is very important for you to understand this concept, because this is not the era of antibiotics anymore. We are not on antibiotics. So we have come up with something new, which is our host modulating agents. So guys, that's it for today's lecture, and I hope that you have really enjoyed the lecture. My whole of my throat is gone, and if you feel that you have learned something new today, then the same story, go ahead and hit the comment box and the like button, because it really helps me to motivates me to put videos for you. Because when I wake up, when I know I have to shoot, when I have throat pain, when I am sick, still I have to shoot. But this is the reason, because of your love, your affection, it keeps on motivating me to put videos for you guys every day, because you have exams coming. So please hit the comment box and the like button if you like the video, because it helped me to help you skyrocket your career and knowledge while you stay at home with your family.